I'd love to be able to say a very warm welcome to you, but the Church of England is getting a reputation today for a cold welcome. I'm sorry, we have two heating systems in our church. Both of them have failed today. I don't know if John would find that amusing or not, but he's not here to sort them out. We did wonder about giving you all a candle to hold in memory of John to warm you up, but we thought that might be dangerous. It is a privilege to welcome you here. John was such a part of our church life here, and welcome to this service in loving memory of him. We had the cremation just an hour ago at Hereford Crematorium. This is a service whereby there's a chance to remember John. We remember him with thanksgiving for all that he was, the person he was, his character, all the good that he did in his life. It's also a time for remembering him with sadness. In this life, we won't see John again, and it's hard to come to terms with that. It's an occasion where words, even emotions, seem very inadequate to saying goodbye to someone we've loved so much. But this is also an occasion for remembering John with hope. Hopefully in this service, it will come across loud and clear, the Christian message of hope. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, even though he die, yet shall he live." Now in our service, we're going to have some memories of John, so I'll hand over the microphone.
John Edward Arnold was born on the 7th of August 1936 at the field, Preston-on-Wye, to Eric and Elizabeth. He was the youngest of three children, Margaret being the eldest, then Noel. He went to Blakemere School and then on to Kingston High School. He learned to play the piano and achieved a grade 5, although he had a preference for the drums, but his mother persuaded him to learn the piano first, and not many people disagreed with her. Of course, he did go on to later to play the drums and said being able to read the music was a great asset to his drumming. He joined the big band playing with his good friend Ambrose on the organ, and they often performed at Parkwall Ballroom. After his school years, he went on to become a builder and bricklayer, and along with Noel joined the firm Houstons, where his father was one of the directors. When Houstons closed down, several members of the team, including John, continued to work together on projects, using their different trades to get the job done. John had many interests over the years, including parachuting, following various sports, and was a long-serving member of this church and the Hereford Lions Club. John was extremely well regarded by all, always willing to lend support and practical help to those he knew. He had a great sense of humour and was a bit of a prankster, loving practical jokes to which many people fell victim. Following is a list of a collection of memories and short stories about John from family and friends. From Tutti. Before Noel and I were married, I remember the times I stayed at the field if Noel, John and I had been out together. I would go to get into my bed to find that the sheets had been apple pied. No prizes for guessing who was responsible. I could hear the two of them giggling in the room, at the room next door. One night we all went to the cinema. While we were waiting to go in, very smart, sporty car went by, and John said, "I'm going to have two of those." He did actually buy one a few years later. From Pauline. Uncle John was witty and enjoyed a joke. He liked his cars, music, and enjoyed playing the drums. On one occasion, Gray and I went to Wormlow to a dance, and John was playing the drums in the band. It went down a storm. We enjoyed ourselves, as did the other people at the dance. Gray volunteered to help Uncle John when he needed an assistant on one of his jobs, repairing and rebuilding a bridge at Elston Park. Gray mentioned Uncle John was a perfectionist regarding his work. Uncle John spent time with Mum giving her support, advice and help when needed. Mum and John enjoyed spending time together. On one occasion, Uncle John wanted to make marmalade. He asked Mum for advice, but he didn't listen to the advice. Instead of using preserving the sugar to help set the marmalade, he used jelly, but the marmalade was too runny to set. Needless to say, that adventure wasn't shared or had on toast. Uncle John made and set up a trap outside his back door to try and get the magpies to stop pecking the tops of his delivered milk. The trap involved using wood, wire, string and bait. It wasn't very successful, but he did eventually catch one bird. It was suggested that the milk bottles could be put into a container or some other method used, but Uncle John wanted to persevere with his homemade trap. He made wooden steps between his house and his neighbour Eamon. Eamon was a good friend of his, and they had a similar sense of humour. So neither of them had to walk down their drives, they just used the steps. This gave them more time to spend together and made resolving various issues easier. From Hazel and Cole. I remember John loved music and played drums in a band. He was a lovely man, very knowledgeable and interesting to talk to. He was a caring brother to Mum. Cole and I loved to see him and Mum sat together on the sofa chatting and sharing memories. On our many trips home from Australia, he was always interested in our life. Even though we are a long way in distance, he will be sadly missed by us both. From Susan Priest. I used to stay at the field with Hazel, John's niece and my cousin, when we were young. John very kindly used to let us use his music room. He showed us how to clean his records and put them on the deck properly, and as long as we did this, we were free to play them. I've always been grateful to John for introducing us to the music of the Drifters and Dave Brubeck, as well as listening over and over with much laughter to The Bricklayer's Lament by Gerard Hoffman. Thank you, John. From Graham Baker. My memories of John are that he was a perfect gentleman and highly respected by many people. His work was none other than first class. He was so good to me and Shirley. He loved his music and found much pleasure in helping other people through the Lions Club. He was very strong-willed, or maybe a little stubborn. I remember Scarlett Knight saying, if you had a difference of opinion with John, you would never win. The very best you would get was a draw. He was a good friend. Thoughtful, reliable, trustworthy, and always there to help. From Mike Jeffries, John loved and helped everyone. He spent time looking after the Hereford Lions Home in Weston-super-Mare and helping local families enjoy holidays there, including helping with driving the minibus. He also helped the Lions with local fundraising efforts. He has a Gold Lions pin badge in his box, which was probably awarded for his long service. John looked out for his sister Margaret and helped to maintain her home. I knew Margaret from my mum's church in Commercial Road Baptist and went with her many times visiting the home Judas Court where she celebrated her 90th birthday. John helped us at church with a wide range of jobs and we often worked together. He always had the right piece of kit on the van. He was always so cheerful. John and I worked on two major projects linked with the bell tower at Homer. The first was in 2000 when we had our bells and frame moved down the floor and refurbished as part of the National Lottery Ringing in the Millennium project. The second job, completed in early October 2009, meant scaffolding the tower to allow us to repair and paint the exterior of the tower from the gold leaf flag at the top down, as well as inside the ringing chamber. I learned from John how to replace broken tiles, repair gutters and patch the end frame. What an inspiration. John was an accomplished drummer and played with local bands. He enjoyed jazz and classical music. From Eunice. There are many memories of times when my late husband Dave Williams was working with John and Noel. Dave would cause them to laugh with his many jokes, and as he was prone to lots of accidents, both the brothers would often have to help him, including driving him to the hospital for stitches, bandaging or repairs. Uncle John Arnold is someone whom my children remember well. He often called at our house to see Dave after work, to either drop off or pick something up for a job. This was usually the time when my children were practicing their music lessons. Jono, who today is a fantastic pianist, was so encouraged by Uncle John in his practicing. We say thank you to Uncle John for his interest in all of our children's activities. One day when I was cleaning upstairs, I decided to throw a rug from my daughter Gwyn's bedroom out through the window down onto the drive so that I could clean it. But unbeknown to me, at that very moment, John was walking underneath and the I narrowly missed him. He walked into the kitchen. I was so shocked to see him, but thankfully he was unhurt. I would often come home to find John and Dave working on something. John would even be up on our roof. On one occasion, he was building a beautiful fireplace in our new lounge. We both loved that fireplace, on which we had many roaring fires, burning offcuts from previous jobs with John sitting having a cup of tea. Thank you, John, for your friendship and encouragement down through the years. Now you are with the Lord and safe and healed as you look upon his face. Thank you.
It's lovely to hear all those memories of John, and hopefully afterwards in the church centre where there is heating, there'll be a chance to share stories with one another, memories of John. We're going to stand and sing now the hymn, How Great Thou Art. going to be read by Erin, curate of our church.
The Bible reading is taken from John chapter 14, verses 1 to 6. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may also. And you know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me."
As you've heard in the memories of John, John was for many years the go-to person in our church. If there was something that was needed to be done on the building, then contact would be made with John and he would help, he would sort things out. And for someone like me, a vicar, such people are wonderful helps because my do-it-yourself skills are practically non-existent. It's good to have people who can do things. Jesus is writing, is speaking to his followers as he faces death and he's preparing them for death. How do we prepare for death? Have we got someone who can help us? And I suppose you could say, yes, well, you can put your affairs into order with a good accountant or a solicitor. That's useful. When it comes to death, yes, you can talk to a funeral director and arrange things and that sort of thing. It may be worth talking to the vicar. He may have ideas for a funeral service and things like that. But actually, there's some very key questions that those people can't help you with. And I'm thinking of questions like, which one of us knows, in a sense, what to do when we die? We believe, or I guess most of us believe, that we have a soul, a spiritual part of our being. Do we have any idea how to separate our souls from our physical bodies? I don't have a clue. I read about it in Marvel comics, where I read about Doctor Strange who can do this, but apart from that, I have no idea how to separate my soul from this physical body. Similarly, even if I were able to manage that, where would I go as a soul? Would I know where on earth to travel, how to get there, what I would need? I would be completely clueless. And my guess is each one of you would be as well. That's why I think these words of Jesus that were read out are incredibly helpful, encouraging, comforting, and hopeful. Jesus basically says, as we come to him with our worries about death, he basically says, "Don't worry, I've got this one." And he has. Because as you read these words, he says, "I'll go to prepare a place for you. Don't worry about it. I'm going to prepare a place for you." That may or may not sound simple, but we know that in order to prepare a place for us, Jesus had to do something very special indeed. Our reading ends with the words, "No one comes to the Father except through me." None of us deserve to go into God's presence when we die. Not one of us can stand up and say, "I've led a perfect life. I deserve that." We all need forgiveness. And that forgiveness is something that Jesus offers us. But it was costly. That's what he was achieving on the cross. So Jesus says, I go to prepare a place for you. I will come again and I will take you to myself. Don't worry about how you're going to make this journey. I'm going to be there. I will take you. And we're going to a place that's prepared for you. It's my Father's house. I love that description. Heaven is not where we're sort of somewhere on the outskirts or vaguely distant from God. It's his house. God wants us close to him. Jesus says the word, so that where I am, there you may be also. Jesus' plan is to be with us, not to be distant from us, but to be close to us. I have lots of questions about heaven. Questions that I don't know the answer to, but this description of my Father's house gives us so much. A home is somewhere where we feel secure, where we can be ourselves, where we're at peace. But most of all, a home, in its best sense, is where we're surrounded by those that we love the best. And that is our great hope, not only of seeing our loved ones again, but of seeing Jesus, the one who loves us so much, the one who says to us, in the face of death, don't worry, I've got this one. Amen. I spoke to John a few months before his death, and he talked about a funeral service, and this was one of the hymns that he wanted. Even though he had a difficult illness to live with, John remained with a twinkle in his eye and a positive spirit. And this hymn is a lovely hymn, just thanking God for the goodness of his world. All things bright and beautiful, let's stand and sing.
Yeah.
flesh, we give thanks to God for John's life. Almighty God, as we bow before you in prayer, we remember that you are our Creator, that you made us in your own image, that you made each one of us unique and loved by you. And so we gather this morning to give you thanks for all those special qualities and characteristics that made John the person that we knew and loved. We thank you for all the good that he did in his life and for the positive ways in which he has affected our own lives. We thank you for the many treasured memories we will always have of him. In Jesus' name, amen. A prayer for those who mourn. God of hope and giver of all comfort, we commend to your tender care all those who mourn John's death. We pray especially for those who were closest to him, that you would give them the strength and support that they will need in days to come. In Jesus' name, amen. A prayer that applies to each one of us, for a funeral reminds us of our own frailty and mortality. And so, Lord, we pray for the common sense to live as people who will one day die. Help us to be prepared for that day when we will stand before your throne and give account of our lives here on earth. Help us to truly repent of all our sins. Help us to make the most of the opportunities we have for doing good. And above all, help us in this life to place our trust in your Son, Jesus Christ, so that at the last, we may rejoice in his presence forever. Amen. We finish our prayers joining in the words of the Lord's Prayer, which is printed in the service booklets. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We stand to sing the hymn, The Day Thou Gainest.
Thank you.
remain standing for the blessing. May God give to you and to all those whom you love his comfort and his hope, his light and his peace in this world and the next. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. I hope you'll be able to join us for refreshments over in the church centre, which is next door but one that way.